grace runs deeper for all enslaved, the ransom paid. Light of the world, yours is.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good morning, everybody. Let's find our seats. How's everybody today? We got some nice weather out there. This is Pastor Stephen's water. All right. We're going to get right into announcements, you guys. We got a lot going on today. Number one on the announcements is just a reminder that we have prayer meetings Sunday mornings before service at 9 a.m. right back here. Anybody who wants to be involved in that, be here. You guys know our heart when it comes to prayer and the importance of it, and get involved somehow in that way. And along with that, just a reminder that we have a new email prayer chain, which is calvarycrystalriver@gmail.com. Just calvarycrystalriver@gmail.com. So if you have any prayer requests, send them over, and we'll make sure they get out. And we will pray together as a family, right? Now, tonight is
Harvest Night.
We're very excited. The day has come. We're going to have a lot of visitors. Hope you guys have been praying alongside us and just praying that we could be a light to the community. Yesterday, George and I were out trying to hand out the rest of the flyers. We kept getting run off from Publix and Walmart, but we got a few out, and I think the Lord will use that. But if you see anybody today while you're out and about, make sure to invite them. It's this evening from 5 to 8, and it's going to be a fun time, you guys. We're super excited, and as far as that goes, anybody who's volunteering, just stay after church for just a quick minute, and I'll let you guys know how all that's going down, okay? And if anybody wants to volunteer and didn't get a chance to sign up, still see me, because we could use all the volunteers that we could get. But it's an exciting time, you guys. We've been looking forward to this and praying for it and building all these games and doing all these things, and tonight we get to just be a light in this community. So even if you're not able to make it out, please keep it in your prayers. As we're having opportunities to share the love of Christ with people who are going to be visiting and all the kids coming in, just lift us up, okay? And if you're not doing anything, come out. Even if you don't have little kids, come visit, come fellowship, volunteer, get in where you fit in, all right? Next on the list, we have men's breakfast coming up this Saturday here at the church from 8 to 9:30, so all you men, come on out, and we'll have some food and fellowship. Don't forget about the women's breakfast, which is the following Saturday at Miss Stefania's house. If you haven't yet, ladies, sign up there in the back, and I think you guys coordinate, like, food and stuff. I don't know. Whatever you ladies do, sign up. Make sure you go. It's a good time from what I hear, and fellowship is just as important for the ladies as it is for the guys, right? Then we have an afterglow service coming up Friday on the 12th. That'll be in the evening from 7 to 8:30. You guys, it's just a sweet time of waiting on the Lord and being in prayer and worship and just considering His goodness, right? So I highly encourage you guys to come out to that if you're available. It'll be a blessed time, okay? And then Sunday the 21st, which is the Sunday before Thanksgiving, we're having a Thanksgiving family Thanksgiving potluck. Bring something to share. We're going to do it right after church. Just, you know, get together, fellowship, consider the things that we're thankful for, and enjoy another excuse to cook food for each other. So that is the 21st, okay? And then last thing, it's not in your bulletin, but just wanted to remind you guys that this Saturday is the grand opening of the thrift store the U-Turn for Christ thrift store. Guys, a lot of work has been put into that. Those guys are working hard. And Jim and Miss Melissa. Okay. And they have a lot of stuff going on. If you guys have any great, awesome things that you don't need anymore that you'd like to donate to the thrift store, let them know. And they will tell you if it's great or awesome enough. No, I'm just kidding. But make sure if you can, you guys, if you can go out there this Saturday, it's from 9 to 2, and they're going to do hot dogs and burgers and drinks and just making a big presence out there. It's a great location. It's right on 44. A lot of people see it. They've had a lot of people coming in already. Praise the Lord, because you guys, this is a good part for the U-Turn ministry to help raise finances and support for the ministry. It's also a great outreach to the community, getting the word out and all of that. So let's support it, okay? And I think that's all I got. So why don't you stand with me and we'll pray and get into some worship. Father God, we are thankful, Lord, to be here today. We're thankful that you have just made a way for us to fellowship with you, Lord, and to have true fellowship with each other. Lord, I pray that right now as we get into worship that we would consider your goodness, your love for us, that you are continually demonstrating for us. Lord, I pray for the service here today that we would just have hearts that are open and ready to receive from you. We're all in different spots in our life and our walk, Lord, but you know exactly where we're at and you meet us where we are. And we're thankful, Lord. So I just pray that we would be ready to receive what you have for us today and that you would be glorified here. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
cast out at sea. And even in death, you were always with me. And when I'm fearful, I won't be afraid. Oh, Spirit. Filled with your glory, filled with your glory. The whole earth is filled, the whole earth is filled. There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain. There's freedom though you've captured me. I've got joy instead of mourning. Sing, there's beauty. There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain. This freedom, though you've captured me, and I've got joy instead of mourning. Yeah, you give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain. This freedom, though you've captured me, and I've got joy instead of mourning. Yeah, you give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, yeah. never been so free, caught in your love for me. I've never been more secure, knowing your heart, Lord. I've never been so free, caught in your love for me. I've never been more secure, knowing your heart, Lord. I've never been so free, caught in your love for me. Never been more secure, knowing your heart, Lord. Never been so free, caught in your love. Cause you give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You haven't seen me till you've seen me filled with joy. And you haven't seen me till you've seen me filled with joy. And you haven't seen me till you've seen me filled with joy. Down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. Give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. Who else commands all the hosts of heaven? Who else could make every king bow down? Who else can whisper in darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What other beauty such praises, what other splendor outshines the sun, what other majesty rules with justice, only a holy God. Father, glory consumes like fire. What other power can raise the dead? What other name remains undefeated? Only a holy God. Just come and behold Him, the one and the only. Just cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Just come and behold Him, the one and the only. Just cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy. Who else could rescue me from my failure? Who else would offer His only Son? Who else invites me to call Him Father? Only a holy God. Only a holy God.
Come and behold Him again. It's lifted high. Come and worship the Lord. I want to sing that chorus one more time, but I just encourage you guys to just take a few minutes before we sing it to just really consider who He is. How holy He is, that He's the God that created the universe. I think sometimes we can just come to church and just kind of get into the routine of things and just forget who it is that we're here for and who it is that we're worshiping. So Father, right now I just pray that You would just bring to remembrance how awesome You have been in our lives and how awesome You currently are. Thank you.
come and worship the Holy. The throne of glory, nothing in my hands I bring, but the promise of acceptance from a good and gracious King. To you my burden, and as you give to me your strength, come and fill me with your spirit, and as I sing to you this praise, serve the greater glory and overcome. I lift my voice to the King in need of nothing, and empty handed I rejoice. Sure.
come, I lift my voice to the King in need of nothing, an empty handed I rejoice. You deserve the greater glory. Overcome with joy, I sing. By your love, I am accepted. You're a good and gracious King.
Father, we just thank you for your grace. Just thank you for your mercy. Thank you, Lord, that you just delight in showing mercy, that it's not like you're up there having to be merciful on us, striving to be merciful on us, but you actually desire to just pour out your grace and your mercy on us. Lord, help us to just walk in that and to really, really understand that. Just to really get the true heart that you have for us, Lord. And to just rest in it. So, Father, I just pray right now for this time that we have to get into your word. Lord, I pray that you would just teach us who you are, Lord, so that when we do come and gather and worship you, Father, we can worship from a place of understanding, from a place of actually being overcome with joy and actually just be worshiping in spirit and truth, because we know who it is that we're worshiping. We really know you. So Lord, as we get into your word right now, would you just open our hearts to just receive the truth of your word deeply? Just show us who you are, Lord. Help us to get it. Not just talk about it, but really get who you are. So Lord, we just give you this time, and we love you, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You guys say hello to each other. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Let's have a seat. Take your seats, take your seats. Let's get into the Word. Does anybody need a Bible? Hey, does anybody need a Bible? If you don't have a Bible, raise your hand. Someone will bring you one. Listen, it's important that you have a Bible in front of you. You need it. We're going to study it today, which is different from what we normally do in here. It's important that you have a Bible so you can hold me accountable to the Word, right? Amen. Study to show yourself approved. Search the Scriptures to see whether or not what I'm saying is actually true. You know, I don't want you to take my word for anything. I want you to see it in the Bible. So have your Bible opens to Romans chapter 9. We've been making our way through the book of Romans. I've told you this multiple times. Romans is my favorite book in the whole Bible, I think. Every time someone asks me what my favorite book is, I say whatever book I'm teaching. But I actually think that Romans really is my favorite. I feel like if I was stranded on a deserted island somewhere and I could have only one book with me, it would probably be Romans. And the reason for that is it has everything you need to know as a Christian is in here. Everything you need to know about salvation, what the Lord has done for you, his sacrificial atonement, the justification that you've now received in him, this imputed righteousness, all the amazing doctrines that we enjoy as Christians are found here in Romans. But on top of that, he goes on then to discuss Israel and God's relationship with Israel and what his eternal plan is for the nation of Israel. And even furthermore, then in Romans chapter 12 and finishing the book, he gives us practical application of how we walk and live and move as Christians now in light of these things. And it's an amazing book. And so as we've been working our way through it, we just finished Romans chapter 8. And Romans chapter 8, I don't know how long we took in Romans chapter 8, but it was a long time. And it was longer than I thought it would take. Romans chapter 9, however, we're switching gears, okay? So Romans chapter 8 is this great triumphant cry of the book of Romans, right? All of the doctrine from Romans chapter 1 leading up to Romans chapter 8, it was building all the way up to that point, this great crescendo of the book of Romans. But what Paul has been doing throughout the whole letter, Paul has been anticipating the objections, anticipating the questions that people would have, and he's answering them beforehand, like a good attorney, right? He's preparing for the objections. So he's ready when they come. Not only is he ready when they come, but he answers them before they even come. You can imagine the hearers, right? The readers, the hearers of Paul's proclamation of these things, and they would start to formulate these questions in their mind, and they, right when they think they got him in between a rock and a hard place, right when they think they have Paul in a place where they're going to question him and throw him off his game, Paul answers the objection before they ever even ask it. And so, really, in Romans 9, 10, and 11, that's exactly what he's doing. Romans 9, 10, and 11 are a section, they're like a parenthetical section within the book of Romans. And what I mean by that is it's like a great parenthesis around these three chapters where Paul takes a second, he stops from what he's been going through, he shifts gears, and he begins to talk about the nation of Israel and God's plan for the nation of Israel. Now, the reason why he does this is a very logical reason. Because as he's been communicating these promises to his church, to us, to the Gentile believers in Jesus, the Jewish believers in Jesus alike, as he's been presenting these amazing truths in this argument, in this great proclamation, and remember the way he ends Romans chapter 8, that he's persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's the way he ends this great chapter, this great section. And you could see how it could lead the Jewish, the Orthodox Jewish unbelievers at the time to question, well, if all of that is true, then what about Israel?
Even the church maybe could come to this conclusion. Well, if all this is true, what about Israel? God has made eternal promises to Israel. God had a plan for the nation of Israel. And now, in light of Jesus, now Gentiles are being saved by grace through faith. And look at the nation of Israel. They haven't yet come into this observance of who Jesus is. They've denied him as a whole. As a nation, they've denied him. As a nation, they're still following the law. So what about Israel? Has God cast them off? Has God changed his mind? The answer, obviously, we know, is absolutely not. God cannot change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if he speaks it, it's true. Not only is what God says true, that's the wrong way to look at it. What God says is true. But what God says is truth, because he is, in and of himself, truth. God is truth. So everything he says is a promise. Everything he says will come to pass. Everything he says has to come to pass, because he is a God who cannot lie. And if he knows from the end from the beginning, and not only does he just know it, but he's declared the end from the beginning. And if he has declared the end from the beginning and everything in between, then he can't change. And the promises that he's made have to be fulfilled. They have to be. Now, I want you to think about the implication of this. It's very important that we really think this out. If the promises that God has made to the nation of Israel, to Israel as a nation, if those things don't have to be fulfilled, if God has changed his mind, then where is the security in the promise that he's made to you? There isn't any. If God could at one moment just change his mind about the promises that he's made, then we are not secure in the promises that we have in Jesus. But the difference, the important thing to know is God doesn't change his mind concerning his promises. I am the Lord your God, I change not. So it's the same yesterday, today, and forever, right? And so Paul begins to deal with that for the nation of Israel in these three chapters. Now, there's a lot of contention and argument and debate over these chapters, especially within the two spectrums, the two great ends of the spectrum of salvation between the sovereignty of God and man's free will and choice. There's a lot of debate on those ends, on those bookends. But listen, these chapters are not very difficult to understand if we keep them in their context and we recognize these three chapters as a whole. Paul is dealing with the nation of Israel in these three chapters. He's discussing national Israel, not the individual Jew, not the individual Gentile, but the nation of Israel and God's plan for that nation, for his chosen people. And so in Romans chapter 9, he begins to deal with that. Now, I want to just... We started last week, we got through the first five verses, but I'm just going to read them over again so we can catch the context of where we are. And so, chapter 9, verse 1, it says, I tell the truth in Christ, I am not lying, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Spirit that I have great sorrow and continual grief in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my countrymen according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertain the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service of God, and the promises, of whom are the fathers, and from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came. And so, Paul starts out strong, right? Paul starts out saying, look, I'm telling the truth, my conscience is bearing me witness in the Holy Spirit, I'm not lying about what I'm about to say. Because what he's about to say is a bombshell. What he's about to say is heavy. He says, I wish I could go to hell in place of my countrymen. Because Paul recognizes that they have rejected Christ. That's the only unforgivable sin they're committing in the present time, the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, denying Jesus Christ. And so Paul is recognizing that unless they come into this recognition of who Jesus is, they're going to hell. And Paul loves them so much that he's saying, I would be willing to be accursed from Christ. If that were possible, which we know it's not, if that were possible, Paul would take their place so that they could come into a relationship with Jesus. That's an amazing statement. And in fact, if Paul wouldn't have prefaced this by saying, look, my conscience bearing me witness in the Holy Spirit that I'm telling the truth, I would think he was exaggerating. But he's not. That's how much he loves the nation of Israel. That's how much he wants to see them come into the promises that God has made them. God made these promises to the nation of Israel. And Paul desires that they would see it. Paul desires that they would step into it, so much so that he says, I'm willing to be a curse from Christ if that would bring them to salvation. And then he says, to whom pertain the adoption, the glory. Now, I want to stop for a second. The adoption there, we talked about it last week. This is not the same thing that we read about in Romans chapter 8, the spirit of adoption that we now have in Christ. The spirit of adoption that lives within us. That's the Holy Spirit. We've been sealed with the spirit of promise until the day of redemption. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And we've received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. It's the Spirit himself that bears witness to our spirit that gives us the ability to call him Father. That is not the same thing. That's an individual adoption. It's not the same thing that Paul is talking about here in Romans chapter 9, to whom pertain the adoption. Paul is talking about the election of the nation of Israel as a promised, as an elect nation of him to bring forth the news of the Messiah to the world, that they are a chosen people. To them pertain the adoption. Now, listen, if God has adopted them, can he unadopt them? If God has adopted them and called them children of his, can a child of yours become not a child of yours anymore? No matter what they do, right? You might write them off. You might put them out of your house. You might do all kinds of things. But they're always your child. Now, I've shared this with you guys multiple times, but this is something that I've had to come to terms with. Well, I had to come to terms with early on in my walk because I had a misunderstanding. I had an understanding that everyone in the world was a child of God. And in fact, I said that very boldly and confidently in a Bible study once that was filled with people who have been studying the Word for a long time, and I got soundly rebuked. And not only did I get soundly rebuked, but I didn't receive it at all. I thought they were wrong. Yeah, whatever, guys. I mean, I know that we're all children of God. And the response was, no, we're all God's creation. We're all created in his image and likeness, but we have a privilege to be called children of God. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us that we should be called the children of God. It's by the adoption that we receive from the finished work of Jesus that now we are accounted as children, adopted into the family of God, unable to be called not children anymore. We are adopted, co-heirs to the kingdom together with Jesus, right? Now the same goes for the nation of Israel. They have been adopted as a nation. God has a plan for the nation of Israel. To whom pertain the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service of God, and the promises. And of whom are the fathers, and from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came. Now listen, this is what the nation of Israel was elect for. The nation of Israel was elect for the purpose of bringing forth the Messiah, to be a special people, a sanctified people, chosen to live out in a way that would glorify the Lord, glorify God, and bring the news of this coming Messiah to the world. Because when the promise was made to God told Abraham that by his seed, in his seed, all the nations of the earth would be blessed. That was the purpose. And why is it that God chose Abraham? I don't know. Your guess is as good as mine. Abraham was a pagan idol worshiper in the land of Ur of the Chaldees. He worshiped false gods, and God just showed up to him and said, hey, I want you to go to a land that I'll show you, and I want you to stop worshiping all these other gods. I want you to worship me because I'm the only true and living God. And when you do that, as you do that, I'm also making you a promise that in your seed all the nations of the earth would be blessed. Abraham was 100 years old. 100 years old. And the Lord is saying, I'm going to give you a son. I'm going to give you an heir. And not only am I going to give you one, but he shows him the night sky, shows him all the stars, and says, look, can you number all these stars? If you could number them, that's the number of your seed. That's the number of your children. I'm going to make you a great nation. So the Lord elects him, chooses him. To him pertain the adoption, right? Brings him into his family. And says, from him is going to come this seed, and I want your people to be sanctified, set apart from the world. I want you to live differently than the rest of the world. I want you to only worship me. And I want you to tell the world of what's coming. To reconcile the whole world who had gone astray, who had started to worship other gods, who had, every one of them, gone their own way, and the Lord allowed them to do that. But then he says, I want them all back. I want them to all come back. And it's going to be through this promised seed. And so, it says in verse 6, oh, I want to finish verse 5, very important verse. Of whom are the fathers, and from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came, who is over all the eternally blessed God. Amen. We talked about that verse last week. We talked about the end of verse 5 and how important that is. It's one of the most direct statements about the deity of Christ in all of Scripture. Whenever you have someone say to you, well, you know, the Bible never says Jesus is God, just bring them to this verse. There's multiple verses that you can bring them to, but this one is one of the most direct verses in all of Scripture concerning the deity of Christ. It says, who is, speaking of Jesus, over all the eternally blessed God. Jesus is the being over all things, God, who is eternally blessed. That's who he is. The Greek literally says that Jesus is the being over all things, God. That's a pretty direct statement, isn't it? So Jesus, being God, came from the lineage of Abraham, from the Jews. And then, so that leads us to the question, okay, if God promised Abraham this, if all of the religious Jews growing up heard these things about the Messiah, that this is what he was coming to do, that he was coming from the seed of Abraham, that he was going to be the promised seed of Abraham, coming from the lineage of David, that he would come forth in Bethlehem, and that he would reconcile the world to himself. And all of the Old Testament prophets, not all of them, but many of the Old Testament prophets specifically say that the Messiah is going to be God in the flesh. And so if all of those things are true, how is it that Israel missed it? Why is it that Israel missed it? How could that be? Was God's word not powerful enough? Was God's word not direct enough? Was it not clearly spoken enough that the Israelites could see it coming? I mean, it was obviously clear enough that the wise men from Babylon could see it coming. Why is it that they missed it? Well, Paul begins to deal with that in verse 6. He says, but it is not that the word of God has taken no effect. You could look at it that way, right? You could see it that way. You could see the nation of Israel not entering into the promise, not entering into faith in this Messiah that has come. And you could say, well, the word of God must not have been effective enough to bring them into an understanding. But Paul said, it is not that the word of God has taken no effect, for they are not all Israel who are of Israel. Nor are they all children because they are the seed of Abraham, but in Isaac your seed shall be called. So what I really love about the first 13 verses of Romans chapter 9 is that Paul is leading us through this election of the nation of Israel. Paul starts with Abraham, right? That in Abraham, all the nations of the earth would be blessed. He talks about the adoption. And then he says that they're not all children because they are the seed of Abraham. And so he makes this promise to Abraham that through him, all the nations of the earth will be blessed, this promised seed. Now, Abraham is waiting on this promise that God has given, and then him and Sarah decide that God can't do it, that God just needs help. And so Abraham lays with his servant, right? And they have Ishmael. And they have Ishmael 14 years before Isaac. And so 14 years later, the Lord comes and says, I'm going to give you a child. And Abraham says, can't it just be Ishmael? Just we did it already. Here he is. Just use him. But he is the child according to the flesh, not according to the promise. And so it says here that they are not all Israel who are of Israel. Now, that sounds a little confusing at first when you just read it that way. They're not all Israel who are of Israel. And the word Israel means governed by God, right? And so he says they're not all of the promise just because they come from the seed of Abraham. That's not how I decided to do it, Remember, if it were just according to his loins, if it were just because of, you know, blood lineage to Abraham, then Ishmael would have been a son of promise, but he wasn't. In fact, when God calls Abraham to sacrifice Isaac, what does he say? I want you to bring your son, your only son, who you love. Well, Ishmael was 14 years older than Isaac, but he was a child according to the flesh, not the promise. So he says, it's not just because they come from the loins of Abraham or the family or the lineage of Abraham that they are governed by God or called Israel, nor are they children because they are all the seed of Abraham, but in Isaac your seed shall be called, in the child of promise. That is, those who are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted as the seed. For this is the word of promise. At this time I will come, and Sarah shall have a son. And so the Lord had given the promise to Abraham, and it was through this promised son that the lineage would come. It was through this promised son that the Messiah would come, not through the son according to the flesh, not by Abraham striving to get it done himself. Now listen, for us, this is we remember the story, we know the story, it's a common story, but it has direct application to our life right now. There are multiple people in this room that the Lord has made a promise to. The Lord has specifically promised something. And you're trying to get it done on your own. The Lord has promised you something, you're excited about it, something that you want. The Lord has said, I'm going to use you in this way, I'm going to give you this, whatever it is. And here you are striving to make it happen. But that's not how it comes. It only comes according to the promise. For this is the word of promise. At this time, I will come, and Sarah shall have a son. The Lord chose to do it a certain way. And there are often times that we see what the Lord desires to do, and we want to get it done our own way, and we start working to make that happen, but that's not the plan God has for us. That's not the way he desires that it takes place. And so, the way he desired that it would take place is through this promise, through Abraham and Sarah, through the promised son, through Isaac. And then in verse 10, he says, and not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one man, even our father Isaac, for the children not yet being born nor having done any good or evil, that the promise of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him who calls. It was said to her, the older shall serve the younger. Now, why is it? Now he's talking about Jacob and Esau. Isaac's sons, twin sons, Jacob and Esau. And the Lord chose Jacob and not Esau. Well, why? Why did the Lord choose Jacob and not Esau? Well, because he has perfect foreknowledge, right? And he knew that Jacob would be a good guy. Well, that would be true until you actually read the Bible. And Jacob was named heel catcher. He was a schemer. Jacob was a scoundrel. And not only was Jacob a scoundrel, so was Esau. Esau looked at the promise of God, looked at the inheritance, and he gave it away for a bowl of soup. He didn't care about it. So why is it that the Lord chose Jacob? I don't know. I have no idea. Why is it the Lord chose you guys? Why is it that the Lord chose me to teach his word? I don't know. I could think of a million better people to do it. And yet the Lord chooses as he wills. He desires to use specific people. He desired that the promise would continue through Jacob and not Esau. And was it because Esau had done something wrong? No. They were in the womb. They hadn't done any good or evil. But it's so that the promise would stand according to God's election. So it was said to her, the older shall serve the younger. Now, listen, that doesn't make any sense. Especially in that culture. The firstborn son would be the right to everything. He would be the heir. He would be the right to all the inheritance of his father. And yet, God says, the older, Esau, shall serve Jacob, the younger. Not only that, but he goes further. As it is written, Jacob I have loved, but Esau I have hated. Jacob I have loved, but Esau I have hated. Now listen, people have a really hard time with that verse. People really do. I mean, I'm sure there are people in this room right now saying, that's difficult for me. What does God mean by that? Jacob I've loved, Esau I've hated. Well, first and foremost, what are we talking about in the context of this chapter? The nation of Israel, right? Jacob is Israel. That's who he is. Esau is Edom. That's their nations that they begot after them, right? And so Jacob is Israel. Esau is Edom. And in fact, in verse 12, Paul is quoting from Genesis here, where it says the older shall serve the younger. And what's interesting about 13 is that he's quoting Malachi. In our Bible, that's the last book of the Old Testament. And in that book, God goes on to describe Esau as being a mountain and a nation. In fact, Edom had become one of the perennial enemies of the nation of Israel, the elect, chosen people of God. Now, did God hate the person Esau? No, he blessed him. In fact, he became a great nation. God didn't hate the person Esau, but he hated what his nation had become. He hated the way that they persecuted his chosen people. And I want you to remember that in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus says, unless you hate your father and your mother and your brother, you're not worthy to follow me. What does he mean there? He's making a comparative statement. He's saying, in comparison to me, he's making a comparative statement between him, Jesus, and people. That your family, God isn't saying to hate your father and mother. He says to honor them, right? He doesn't change his mind. Honor your father and your mother. But he's saying, compared to the way you're going to follow me, serve me, love me, there should be no comparison. And God's saying of Jacob here, Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated, Jacob I have preferred, Jacob I have chosen. And in regards to this election, in regards to the promise, Esau is not a part of it. I've chosen Jacob. Now listen, I wish that I could give you some amazing insight as to why God chose to do it this way, but I can't. Because he is God and I'm not. And maybe you're coming to this verse and you're saying, no, that's not right. I have a problem with that. You want to argue with God about it. Have at it. I just want to tell you, if you're arguing with God, you're wrong and he's right. Period. Jacob I have loved and Esau I have hated. What shall we say then? Listen, Paul recognizes this is a difficult thing. Paul recognizes this is a difficult doctrine. This is difficult for us to study. It's difficult for us to hear. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? Certainly not. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. So then it is not of him who wills, nor of him who runs, but of God who shows mercy. That means it's God's prerogative. It's not of him who runs, not of him who wills, not of the one who's striving, not of the one who's desiring, but of God who decides to show mercy. Here's the truth, okay? Charles Spurgeon says that someone came up to him after a sermon and said, no, I have a real problem with this whole Esau I've hated thing. And Charles Spurgeon says, yeah, me too. But what I have a problem with is how he could love Jacob. Not that he could hate Esau, but how could he love Jacob? How is it that God could decide to love a heel catcher, a scoundrel like Jacob? But God says to Moses, I will have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. That's it. It's his prerogative to show that mercy. So here's the truth. We're going to get into this a little bit later in verse 22, but I want to touch on it now. Everyone who's ever been born since Adam, everyone is deserving of the wrath of God. Everyone. In Ephesians, it says that we are, by our nature, children of wrath. That's who we are. That we were in rebellion to God. That we knew right from wrong. We know the truth of who God is. It's clearly evident in creation, right? His eternal Godhead and power. His invisible attributes are clearly seen in nature. We know good from evil. We're made in his image and likeness. And yet we rebel. Because it's in our nature to. And yet we desire to be at war with God. And yet we desire to make ourselves the center of worship in our life. Everyone is deserving of wrath. And yet, God decides to show mercy. That's the difference, right? It's not that Esau was chasing after God. The nation of Edom wanted God, and they were desiring him, but he hated them, so he pushed them away. It wasn't that. It's that they didn't want anything to do with him. And he decides to show Israel mercy. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. So then, it is not of him who wills, nor of him who runs, but of God who shows mercy. Verse 17, for the scripture says to the Pharaoh, for this very purpose I have raised you up, that I may show my power in you, and that my name may be declared in all the earth. Therefore, he has mercy on whom he wills, and whom he wills he hardens. You will say to me then, why does he still find fault? For who has resisted his will? Another logical question, another logical objection to what Paul is saying. Well, how is it then can God actually find fault in people who don't follow after him if everyone is subject to the will of God? They have no choice. For this very purpose, the scripture says, for this very purpose he raised up Pharaoh so that he could show his power in the world. Well, what happened to Pharaoh? It wasn't good. But God raised Pharaoh up as a great nation, raised Egypt up as a great nation, even knowing the rebellion that Pharaoh would have towards a holy God. And you will say to me then, why did he still find fault? For who has resisted his will? I love this because that is a common question today. You'll hear it in debate after debate after debate after debate. If you desire to watch those things, which you have better use of your time, by the way, than watching debates, I would say just read the Bible. That's a way better use of time. But I have this sick need to watch them sometimes between Christians and non-Christians and atheists. I watch these debates. And this is a common question. Well, this is fatalism then. How can anybody... Look, it's not my fault if I am the way I am because who can resist the will of God? I love this. Paul answers it very straightforward. But indeed, oh man, who are you to reply against God? I love that. All right, you got questions. Well, we got answers. Then how is it that God can find fault because who can resist his will? Well, who are you to question God? That's the answer. God is God and you are not. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are so much higher than our thoughts. There is God in every other created thing. But indeed, O man, who are you to reply against God? Will the thing formed say to him who formed it, why have you made me like this? Does not the potter have power over the clay from the same lump to make one vessel for honor and another for dishonor? What if God, wanting to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much long suffering the vessels of wrath prepared for destruction? And that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had prepared beforehand for glory. Even us, whom he called, not of the Jews only, but also of the Gentiles. Now listen, like I said, this section of scripture is highly debated. It is a source of argument in the church, probably from the time it was written, okay? Because anytime there's difficult things that are higher than our intellect, that are above our intellect, that are difficult for us to wrap our minds around, what we love to do as prideful men is think we have it all figured out and debate with each other about it, right? But really, when you look at it, it's not that difficult to understand. Remember, God is talking about the nation of Israel. In these three chapters, this is national election that God is dealing with, okay? And he says here, what if God, wanting to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much long suffering the vessels of wrath prepared for destruction. In this context, remember, it said that God loved Jacob and hated Esau. Esau was Edom and a picture of the Gentile nations. He endured with much long suffering the nations of the Gentiles of the world in their pagan worship, in their idolatry, in their mistreatment of the Jewish people, in their persecution of God's elect, and yet God endured with much long suffering so that we could be sitting here right now. He could have wiped them all out and just left Israel. He could have gotten rid of everyone and just left Israel, but God had an eternal plan in place, right? Very much the same way that he has an eternal plan for the nation of Israel, and that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had prepared beforehand for glory. So what happens is people will take verses 22 and 23 and they'll draw conclusions from that concerning individual people right now, and they'll say, see, God has made vessels, meaning people, for dishonor and destruction. God has created human beings, specifically some of them, to go to hell. That's not what I read here. That's just not what I read here, and that's not what I see in the character of God. God says, whosoever wills may come. He takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked. He desires that they would rather turn and live. Remember what he says as he weeps over Jerusalem. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how long I've wanted to gather you. Like a mother hen gathers her chicks. But what does he say of them? But you were not willing. Here in verse 22, it says that there were vessels of wrath prepared for destruction. Who did the preparation of those vessels for destruction? The vessels did. They did. It doesn't say anything about God preparing them for destruction. It just says that they are prepared for destruction. And why is it? How is it that they're prepared for destruction? Because they walk in the system of the world, which is set in motion by the prince of the power of the air, and they are, by their very nature, children of wrath. But then it goes on to say, and that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy. Whose prerogative is it to show mercy? God's. Not of him who wills, not of him who runs, but of God who shows mercy. So he is, make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he, God, had prepared beforehand for glory. I have no problem with the doctrine of election. I have no problem with doctrines of predestination, election, God's perfect foreknowledge. We just went through them in Romans chapter 8. I think they're glorious, glorious doctrines. I have no problem with the fact that God has chosen me, because I didn't choose it. I didn't do it. He gets all the glory for it, right? He chose me. He's the one who drew me. He's the one who wooed my heart. He's the one who gave me this choice, gave me this faith. It was a gift from him. And so it's his prerogative to show mercy on whom he wills. And on whom he wills, he hardens. And here it says that he wants to show the richness of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had prepared beforehand for glory. Now listen, like I said last week, can't remember who it was. I think it was Spurgeon again who said this, and I love this quote. I know for a fact that God chose me before I was born because he wouldn't have chosen me afterwards. I have no problem with that truth. And so it says that he prepared beforehand for glory, even us, whom he called, not of the Jews only, but also of the Gentiles, as he says in Hosea. Now, if you've been coming Wednesday nights, we've been studying through the minor prophets. Just recently, we went through the book of Hosea. It's a glorious book. And here in verse 25, he quotes it. He says, I will call them my people who were not my people, and her beloved who was not beloved. And it shall come to pass in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people, there they shall be called sons of the living God. That's us, guys. That's us. Gentiles who were without hope in the world, who were alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, who had none of the promises that in Christ, the middle wall of separation, that middle wall of partition has been torn down, so that now there is neither Jew nor Greek in Christ, but there's one new man, and that is the church. So we, who were once called not a people, who were not a nation, who were alienated from the promises of God, have been adopted, and there they shall be called sons of the living God. Isaiah also cries out concerning Israel. Though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, the remnant will be saved. This is the culmination of what Paul has begun to talk about here. What about Israel? Well, Isaiah cries out concerning Israel, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, though the number of the children of Israel will be very great, innumerable, they'll be covering the world, the remnant will be saved. For he will finish the work and cut it short in righteousness, because the Lord will make a short work upon the earth. And as Isaiah said before, unless the Lord of Sabaoth had left us a seed, we would have become like Sodom, and we would have been made like Gomorrah, utterly wiped out. Verse 30, what shall we say then? That Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have attained to the righteousness, have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness of faith. But Israel, pursuing the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness. Why? Because they did not seek it by faith, but as it were, by the works of the law. For they stumbled at the stumbling stone. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. Listen to that. This is important, guys. This is important for you to understand. I want you to wrap your mind around it. I want you to wrap your arms around it. Bring it into you. Live by these things. This is important. He says that the Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness. I want you to think about this. When the gospel goes forth from Jerusalem, and Paul goes on his missionary journeys, and they begin to spread north and into Europe and all these places, where are they going? They're going to the cities of the Gentiles, and what are they doing in these cities? They are worshiping false gods. They're committing immorality. They're completely immoral and pagan. They were not pursuing God. They were not pursuing a holy God. They were just wanting to do whatever they desired in their flesh, and they were fulfilling it all the time. And Paul is saying here, what shall we say then? The Gentiles who didn't pursue righteousness attained to righteousness, even the righteousness of faith. And the Jews who were trying to live according to the law and doing all the things they could do to please God and keeping all the ordinances and commandments and checking off all the boxes, that they didn't attain to righteousness, even the righteousness of the law. Why? Because they didn't pursue it by faith. It was always by faith. That was always the plan of God from the very beginning. Remember what he says to Abraham, that in your seed all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And then what happened with Abraham? He believed. He believed God about that promised seed. He believed God about the Messiah. He believed the promise that God had made, and it says that it was accounted to him as righteousness. That he was accounted righteous by faith 430 years before the law was ever given. Years before circumcision, Abraham was accounted righteous by faith in the Messiah. It was always by faith. And the reason why national Israel misses it is because they're not pursuing God by faith. They're pursuing him through the works of the law. Now we know by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified. The law is a mirror to show us how short we come of the standard of God, which is perfection. The law is a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. It shows us how short we fall of the glory of God and how desperate we are in need of a Savior. But Israel still pursues God through the works of the law, still trying to attain to righteousness, still trying to measure up, and they do not pursue him by faith. But they stumble at the stumbling stone. The stumbling stone is Jesus. He is the stumbling block. You mean it's that easy? I've been working my whole life at this. I've been keeping the law since I was a youth. I've been doing everything I can do this right. I've been keeping the Ten Commandments. I've been keeping the Sabbath holy. I haven't ever eaten unkosher food. I've done everything right. And you're telling me all I have to do is believe? No way. It can't be that easy. I will not accept it. I'm better than all these Gentiles. There's no way. It can't be that easy. At least I'm preferred over them, right? It's a stumbling stone. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. You can have all the debates you want to about election. You can have all the debates you want to about predestination. You can have all the debates you want about vessels for wrath and vessels for mercy. But this is what it all comes down to. There is in Zion a rock of offense and a stumbling stone. His name is Jesus. And whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. That's what we believe. That's the important part. Right now, where you sit today, are you trusting and believing in Jesus? Now, I want you to recognize that that word believe is a verb. It's something that you do. Are you submitted to that which you know to be true? Have you submitted your heart to that which you know in your mind is true? And if you believe in him, then you will not be put to shame. It's that simple. Let's pray. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. We're going to end with just a song of worship. We have every reason this morning to praise the Lord. We have every reason to worship. Listen, I don't know what you're going through in your life. I don't know what difficulties you're facing. I don't know what struggles you're in or what persecution you faced at your job or your workplace or by your family, what trials you're in. I don't know what you're going through, but I know you're all going through something. But here's what I know. The sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. So you have two choices. You can feel sorry for yourself or you can praise the Lord. I'm going to choose to praise the Lord. Father, we just are so grateful for these truths. Lord, I pray for those that are here right now who are in a struggle. Father, but I pray that you would just speak to their hearts and show them your goodness, even in the midst of it, Lord. How much you love them, Lord, that you desire to die for them, that you stepped down from the throne room of heaven, that you came to die so that they could be forgiven, that you've washed them in your blood, Lord, that you've adopted them into your family, that you call them sons and daughters. They're joint heirs together with Jesus to the kingdom. Father, I pray that if there's anyone here who doesn't know you, who hasn't made that decision for you, Lord, who hasn't believed on you, I pray that today would be the day of salvation, Lord, that you would move their heart to say yes to the grace that you offer freely. It's your desire to show mercy. Lord, you delight in showing mercy. Father, would you bring us into that place where we're washed by your grace? We love you, Lord. We give you all the honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you stand with me? Let's worship the Lord.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Hey, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Hey, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Let's sing, worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Sing, you lay down your life.
Lay down your life. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen. Amen. Hey, so I want to remind you guys, tonight is harvest night. Okay, so be back here. I'm excited. All the kids are excited. It's going to be fun. If you want to hang out for the day, there will be people here all day. If you sign up to help set up, be here at 3 o'clock, okay, so we can start setting up. But other than that, you guys be blessed for the week. I can't wait to see you guys on Wednesday, right? And then on Sunday, if you don't come on Wednesday. Listen, we're starting a new book this coming Wednesday, Habakkuk. So come and be a part of it. You'll be blessed. It's amazing what the minor prophets will show you and what it speaks of there. So try to make it out on a Wednesday night. Also, in other news, Corey's whole family is here. They're sitting back there. See the guy with the beautiful beard? It's my best friend Ryan. So before you guys leave today, go talk to Ryan, okay? And his beautiful wife Rachel, and then Corey's mom in the back, okay? Make sure you make them welcome.
She's leaving for Kenya on Monday.
Oh, and she's leaving for Kenya. Come up here, let's pray for her. Do I have anything else I'm supposed to say? No? All right, good. Let's pray over her. Would you guys just agree together with me in prayer? Lord, we're so grateful for the ministry in Kenya. Lord, we're so grateful for what you're doing there. We're grateful for Carrie and for Randy and for Pastor Dennis and for Casey over there. Lord, we just pray that you would continue to do this amazing work. Lord, we pray that you would continue to just pour out your love and your spirit on that place. Lord, continue to use them mightily for your kingdom, God. We desire that just more would be saved. More would come into your kingdom. That we would see it grow, Lord, that we would see a mighty work over there, even mightier than what we've seen already. Lord, we're just grateful that we get to be even just a small part of it, Lord, to pray for them and to lift them up. And Father, we just pray that you would remind us to be praying for that ministry. Lord, I lift up Carrie to you right now and just pray for traveling mercies, Lord, that you would just protect her as she goes back. Lord, that you would make all of the interactions and everything she has to do going through the airport smooth, Lord, that you would just make everything easy. And we praise you even beforehand, knowing that you're good, knowing that you will. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 And Lord, for your church, I just pray that you would just continue to bless them this week. Lord, continue to use them as lights in the world, as salt. Father, that everyone who sees them, everyone who comes in contact with them, would just see the love of Christ in them. Lord, I pray for opportunities this week. I pray for your church to be bold in those opportunities, Lord, that they would stand fast in their faith, unwilling to compromise. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Love you guys.